come yet, but if you'll take this time, meet and greet your neighbor this morning, tell everybody you're glad to see them. We're going to sing a song in just a minute, but take this time and greet your neighbor.
Also want to welcome our first-time guests, and if you are a first-time guest, we have a special gift bag we'd like to get to you, and we need you to raise your hand up really high at this time, and one of these ladies will get that to you. And if you are a visitor, you might check out our new visitor center located out to the left of the foyer when you go out today for some more information about the church. As far as announcements today, there will be a wedding shower for Sam Massey and Evan Palumbo today at 3:30 back in the fellowship hall. Also, there are several meetings in the bulletin, the Baptist women, the sewing class, and the Game Changers meeting coming up. Also, Young at Heart will meet Tuesday, May 7th, and I was asked to announce that they'll meet here to eat, and they'll be taking a bus out to Vernon Aggie's house. Also, there's a Vacation Bible School meeting coming up, too. I left that out. It'll be Wednesday night, May 15th. After evening services, and Amy has told me they do need kitchen workers for VBS, so if you can help in the kitchen, just please let Amy Smithy know. And I think Slayton got a golf announcement.
Thank you.
Probably good we wasn't having a softball tournament. Those might hurt a little worse. So, that's all I have today. We have any birthdays this past week?
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
Thank you once again for being here, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we do thank you for this day you've blessed us with, and we thank you for this rain that you've blessed us with and the nice sunshine we've had this morning, Father, and we just pray that you'll just continue to bless this church, that you'll just bless the rest of this service. We just pray that everything we do throughout our days will just glorify your name, and we just pray that you just guide and lead and direct us always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, the last few weeks we've learned a lot about heaven. We're going to start singing about heaven this morning. So sing with us this morning when we all get to heaven.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you so much for allowing us to come to your house and worship. We thank you so much for the choir. These songs are so beautiful. We just thank you for them and how they lead us in worship. We just pray, Lord, that as we come to this part of the service, that each of us will understand that we're to return a portion of our goods to you, that they might be used to the furtherance of your kingdom. We pray this morning that you would forgive us of our many shortcomings. We pray also that you would give us strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
Got a special this morning for you, special song. Do you know our Father's house is a big house full of many rooms that he's prepared for you and me. So we've got a special treat. These girls are going to come up and sing a song for us this morning, talk about how big that house is.
Go with me to my Father's house. own, so why not come with me? Come and go with me to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of room. A big, big table with lots and lots of food. A big, big yard where we can play football. A big, big house. It's my Father's house. A big, big house with lots and lots of room. Come and go with me to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of room. A big, big table with lots and lots of food. A big, big yard where we can play football. A big, big house. It's my Father's house. A big, big house with lots and lots of room. My Father's house.
Amen. Thank you for doing that song. That came out in 1994, and I remember it quite well, first time I heard it sang. This is the fourth and last message in our series on heaven. And I don't know about you. I know if there's two people in this building that like to hear about heaven, it is Shirley Turner, right back there, and me. We love talking about heaven. And when you have someone in heaven, we all have the Lord Jesus, but when you have someone that you're close to that's gone to heaven, it just makes it a little more sweeter. It makes the desire to go just a little more intense. The last in this series is entitled, Excuse Me, But Do You Have a Reservation? Friday, Sandy and I drove to Fayetteville for Brianna's graduation. Was it a college graduation? No. High school graduation? No. Middle school graduation? No. Elementary graduation? No. I didn't even know they had graduations for what we went for. It was a preschool graduation. But it was so important, we drove over. And in fact, we told her we would have it a big, big time. And we rented a hotel room so we could take she and her sister swimming. And we went to the Homewood Suites in Fayetteville, Arkansas. I walked in because I had made the confirmation. Or Sandy had, one of us had. It doesn't matter, one of us had. And I walked in, and the lady wants to know what my name is. I said, my name's John Hodges, and I have a reservation for tonight, one night only. And she starts pecking on her computer and says, well, I don't find you here. And I said, well, check again. I have a confirmation number right here. I said, aren't you 4403? West Walnut, Rogers, Arkansas, and she said, no, we're not. I had made a reservation, but it was at the Homewood Suite in Rogers, Arkansas. So I said, can you transfer? And she said, no, I can't. So we got in the car, and we drove to Rogers, Arkansas. I was preparing for this message, and I was thinking about that, and when you do make a reservation, you need a confirmation number, amen? And as you have a confirmation number, you can say, I did make this reservation, and I know this reservation is authentic because of this. And when you make a reservation, it guarantees you a spot in the hotel room. But when you make a reservation for heaven, it guarantees you a spot in heaven. And I was researching online, and if you want to go online and look at this, it's called reserveaspotinheaven.com. And what you can do, you can get online and you can reserve a spot in heaven. I mean, you can, all you have to do is type in your name or who you want to give the gift to, and you can, for $14.95, you can guarantee a spot in heaven. By the way, if you'd like an upgrade, it's only $10 more. You can have a VIP pass to anywhere in heaven. $25, that's all it takes. You know, I've wondered if you have a complaint, how do you make it? If your reservation's not reserved, who do you complain to? I know this is a spoof because it says you can make a reservation in hell as well, and you can do it for the same price. But I want you to know something. You need to reserve a spot in heaven. There's only one way to do it, and that's through the Lord Jesus Christ. P.T. Barnum said, there's a sucker born every minute, and there is. And so many people have been misled or have misunderstood, or they are simply the product of someone who has duped them. But you know, right now, it's amazing to me is, I guess, as cosmopolitan as our culture is, there is still a great interest in the Bible. There is a great interest in the Bible. People are desiring to know what the Bible has to say. And in fact, I know this to be true because the History Channel most recently put on a series, an animated series, about heaven. And this series was the widest viewed TV program during that time. In fact, it is estimated that 1 in 4 people in the United States viewed the Bible. That's 25%. They tell me, and this is Barna Research, that not only 1 out of 4 Americans watched the History Channel, but when it goes and becomes an international syndicated program, that over 1 billion people worldwide will watch this series. Now, there is a great interest in the Bible. There's a great interest in the reality of heaven. But unfortunately, so many people have been misled and they do not understand the truth of God's Word. Now, if you want to find out about heaven, all you have to do is go to your local bookstore and go down the aisle and go to the religion section, and then you start looking at books about heaven. I mean, there are a plethora of books about heaven. In fact, in the last 20 years, it seems to have exploded. And I remember we had a guy here in our church named Don Piper. And Don Piper wrote a book that was very popular. It was called 90 Minutes in Heaven. And Don spoke, and, you know, it was fine. And then little Todd Burpo, who is 4 years old, he had this experience, and he wrote a book with his family, and it's called Heaven is for Real. And he went to heaven, supposedly, came back, and as a little boy, he told his dad, he said, Jesus had markers. And he said, what do you mean? And then what he meant was these piercings in his hands and his feet. Well, is that true? Well, it sounds pretty good. And then most recently, the one I'm most familiar with was by an orthopedic surgeon named Dr. Mary Neal. And she had turned upside down in a kayaking trip, and for 15 minutes she was submerged in the water, and she came back and said that she had been to heaven. Now, I'm not casting doubt on any of these people's experiences, but here's what I would say. They didn't die. They had a near-death experience. And there is a great difference between a near-death experience and a death. One of them is complete. One of them is partial. So what I guess I would really say is they had a no-death experience because none of these were resurrections. They were all resuscitations. But there has been one in history that is an absolute resurrection, and that is Jesus Christ. So Jesus died, rose again. So you might want to read 90 Minutes in Heaven, by Don Piper. You might want to read Heaven is for Real by Little Todd Burpo. And you might even want to read the orthopedic surgeon Mary's book about To Heaven and Back. But I'm going to tell you, the book that I trust more than any is this book. Because this book is not going to lead you astray. It's going to give you the straight from the guy who went there and then returned. Now, I've taught a number of things about heaven in this series, but I want you to stand. We're going to give you four more before we conclude. This isn't a very familiar passage. It's in John 14. If you'll stand with me in the honor of God's word, it says in verse 1, "Let not your heart be troubled." Remember, this was a night before Jesus would leave them, go to the cross, die. And he said, "You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house," that's the song these young girls just sang, and I'm so grateful, "there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." The word topon is a real, literal, physical, identifiable place. "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me." Father in heaven, I do pray that today, before we leave this place, that everyone will know if they have a reservation in heaven or not. And I pray, Lord, if they do not, that they would before they leave. And I pray if they do, that they would confirm that reservation and be absolutely certain of that, that they would have a no-so salvation. And I pray, Father, that you might just take this passage and this message and place it upon our hearts and our minds and help us to always realize you are the way, the truth, and the life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated. We've talked about a number of things leading up to this last message in the series of four. And I want to give you four more things about heaven before we leave here today. And they'll be on the board, but you might want to write them down or take notes. First thing I want you to understand is Jesus is preparing us a place. He's preparing a place for us in heaven. Jesus ascended back to heaven, and after he had been on earth after the resurrection 40 days, he went back for good, and he went to live where he had been for all eternity. And as he's been back in heaven, he has been preparing a place for us. In verse 2 of John's gospel, it said, "If I go and prepare a place." Now that place is real. It is literal. It is not an ethereal type of place. It is an absolute place. It is an identifiable place. It is as real or more real than anything we could possibly know or understand today. In fact, the word place is the word, the Greek word mone, M-O-N-E. And mone has been mistranslated, if you will. In most of our Bibles, we get mansions out of that. It said, "I go to prepare a mansion for you." And it's not mansion, it's really a house. And it's a big, big house, as the song says. Audio Adrenaline actually got it right. We have a tendency to think each one of us are going to have identifiable mansions with nameplates above them in suburbs, and we'll just kind of go from street to street and place to place, and we're going to be so excited about our mansion. And some people say, "Well, just give me a little cabin in the corner glory," but that's not how it's going to be. The concept is mone, and it is a house. I love to say this. It came out on a movie a number of years ago. I've changed it just a little bit. What I want to say when I get there is, "Show me the mone." Now, that's show me the house. Not show me the money, but show me the house. And when we get to heaven, we're going to say, "Show me the house. I want to see the big, big house." And that is going to be an incredible place as we arrive there. Now, don't get the image in your mind that you're going to have a mansion. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 says these words. It says, "We know that if our earthly house," we talked about that in an earlier sermon, "our earthly house is this physical body. This tent is destroyed. We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." We know that we're going to depart this place. I'm going to depart this body. In fact, when I look at it, it is growing weary and it is dying even now. I look out and I see some of you. Some of you, your bodies are in pretty foul shape. Now, I look out and I see some balding tops. I see some bulging middles. I know some of you have varicose veins. And I know some of you, just by seeing you, have highway hips. Some of you have thunder thighs. Some of you just simply say, I wish I had the body that I've always wanted. Well, I want you to know something. You can struggle and strive here on planet Earth to get that body, but it won't last. You see, you can exercise and exercise and exercise, and you can say, I'm fit and I'm trim, and I've got this six-pack of abs, and look at me, all of these muscles and strands, and my veins stick out. Well, you go a month without exercising, see what happens. You see, that muscle turns to fat. It just goes away. But you see, in heaven, we won't have a weakened body. We'll have a perfect body. And I know I spoke about this in an earlier sermon, and one of my brothers said, Brother Anderson said, I think we'll be 33, because that's when Jesus died, at age 33. We'll have perfect bodies at 33. I don't know. I don't know how old we're going to be, but I do know this. We're all going to be well. Everything is going to be good. We're going to be in a perfect place with a perfect body. Now, in 1994, when Audio Adrenaline came out with this song, Big, Big House, it was the best thing on the market. I mean, we loved to sing it. We sang it at church camp. We sang it at church where I was at that time. It was wonderful. And as a believer, I can't wait to get to that big, big house. Now, here's often what people say about those of us who are Christians. They'll say, you know what? You Christians have this pie in the sky mentality. All you think about is pie in the sky by and by. Well, I've got news for them, and I've got news for you if that's what you have always thought. I want you to know something. It's not just pie in the sky by and by. It's steak on the plate while you wait. Hey, I mean, the Christian life is a good life, amen? I mean, we have it made. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, patience, all of these attributes, all of the fruits of the Spirit, we get to enjoy now. So it's not just pie in the sky by and by. Brother, it's steak on your plate while you wait. It is good. And we need to realize life is meant to be lived now. The abundant life that Christ has given us is for now, and it is forever. I love what C.S. Lewis had to say, and I've been quoting C.S. Lewis a lot in this. If you want to borrow these books, I have them all. he said this about people saying we're so earthly minded that we're so heavenly minded we're no earthly good. He wrote this, and I really like this, and so I'm going to read it. He said, throughout history, the Christians who did most for this present world were those who thought most of the next. Early Christians left their mark on earth precisely because their minds were preoccupied with heaven. It is since Christians ceased thinking of the other world that we have become so ineffective in this one. Aim at heaven and you'll get the earth thrown in. Aim at the earth and you'll miss both. Whew. That is so true. You know the thing that was so important? America was made up of small country churches. And each small country church had windows. And you could look out those windows. And every old country church had something outside of that church building you could see through those windows. You know what it was? A cemetery. And they could look out those windows, and they knew they were just a heartbeat from here to there. And we've come to the place that we no longer think about those things. And we say, well, you know, I can just put it off. I can go to the doctor. I can get better and stronger. I can live longer and longer and longer and longer. But I'm going to tell you, it's going to be over one day. And there's a big, big house that's been prepared. But you have to be prepared to go to that big, big house. You just don't get to go because you die. The second thing I want you to understand is this about heaven. You can be certain. You can be certain about your eternity in heaven. People say, oh, you just can't be sure. I mean, you can live good and try hard, and you can be the best you can be, but you just can't be certain that you're going to go to heaven. Listen, I want you to know something. You can be sure. You can be sure that the day you die, you will end up in glory, or as I have said, the day that I die, I'll be more alive than ever. That'll be the best day that I've ever lived. You don't have to wait till you die to know if you're going to heaven. I mean, that's wrong. That's poor theology, and that's poor Bible. You can know. How do I know we can know? John, you're just saying, because 1 John 5:13 said, "These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may," what? Say it with me, "know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may," K-N-O-W, "that you may know that you have eternal life." You don't have to think about it. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to consider it. You can know. People say, "Well, if you're good, you'll go to heaven." No, you don't go to heaven because you're good. You go to heaven because you're saved. You say, "Well, if I keep the Ten Commandments," you can't keep the Ten Commandments. "Well, if I attend church, if I pray, I do all these things." No, 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 no. There's only one way, and that is the blood-bought way of Calvary. And we have to come to the place we say, "Lord, not my way, but thy way. Lord, I'll just totally trust you and cast all my cares upon you, because I know you care for us, and I know your burden is light and your yoke is easy. And God, here is all of me. I give it to all that I know of you." Listen, we don't have to say, "I hope I dwell in the Father's house forever." We can know that we're going to dwell in the Father's house forever. We don't have to say, "Well, I might dwell in the Father's house forever." We can know that we'll dwell in the Father's house forever, because the Bible says that we will. We will. It was certain of heaven. Critics now dismiss our faith, and they say this about our faith, and they'll say, "You know what? Christianity is just another fairy tale." And in fact, you've seen the atheist movement that's really amped up their propaganda about Christianity. They say, "I'll put on billboards Snow White, Cinderella, Sleeping Beauty. The prince and the princess marry and have a wonderful life, and they live happily ever after." And they've started putting up these billboards, and they'll say, "What does Christianity have in common with these?" Oh, here's the answer. They're all fairy tales. They're all fairy tales. Well, I want you to know something. This is no fairy tale. This is absolute truth and certainty. When we leave here, we can go to heaven. Here's why they say it's a fairy tale. Now, you know something? Do you know why legends? Do you know why fairy tales? Do you know why they always have this happy ever after concept, this mentality? I mean, because here it is. God has placed within our hearts happiness. He has placed within our hearts eternity. Ecclesiastes 3:11 says that God has placed within our hearts eternity. Do you know what he's saying? He has placed within us the desire to go to heaven and be with him and to live happily ever after. Listen, that is incredible to know that we can do that. The problem is so few people will give their heart and their life completely to the Lord. They'll say, "Well, I just don't know, and I think that Christianity is just like a big fairy tale." You know, just because there's this instinctive desire to have this happily ever after life doesn't negate the fact that it's a reality. I mean, that's an intrinsic longing within each of us, this desire in our hearts to know and believe heaven exists. In fact, I want to read another from J.I. Packer, and I want you to hear this. J.I. Packer is a great theologian. I love to read Packer. He says these words: "As I get older, I find that I appreciate God and people and the good and lovely things more and more intensely." Those of you who are getting older like me, would you agree to that? Yes. "So it is pure delight to think this enjoyment will continue and increase in some form, literally forever. In fact, Christians inherit the destiny which fairy tales envision and fancy. We live and live happily, and by God's endless mercy will live happily ever after." That's in Your Father Loves You, page 68. Now, I'm telling you, it is an absolute reality and an absolute blessing to know that we can live happily ever after, because most in this room would say, "My life certainly isn't happy right now. I am struggling. I am caught in this funk, and I'm unable to get out, and I don't know what's next." Listen, God will give you happy here and happy there, but you need a no-so salvation to experience that. Third thing I want you to understand today is this: there's a book in heaven with names written on it. There is a book in heaven with names that are written on it. You know what those names are? The reservation, just like me checking that hotel room. And you check the computer. Not here, Mr. Hodges. Your reservation isn't here. Your name is not written down. Well, I want you to know something. The Bible says there's a book in heaven, and it has names in it. It's called the Lamb's Book of Life. And that Lamb's Book of Life, when you trust Jesus Christ, the very Lamb of God, your name's placed in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that Book of Life is as real as the Word of God says it is. In fact, when you go back and you start studying the Old and New Testament, you find that Moses was the very first person who talked about the Book of Life. Moses said, listen, after the rebellious children of Israel, when he came down from Mount Sinai and they were partying and built the golden calf and he destroyed the Ten Commandments, and then he began praying on their behalf. He said, God, if it be your will, preserve this people. Even blot my own name out of your book in Exodus chapter 32. But Lord, preserve this nation. King David said this in Psalm 139 verse 16. He said, your eyes saw my substance, being yet unformed, and in your book they are all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. Listen, David talked about the book of life. Moses spoke about the book of life. Jesus spoke about the book of life. Nevertheless, he said, do not rejoice in this, that your spirits, the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Is your name written down in glory? And then John spoke of this in Revelation 21 when he was on the Isle of Patmos. There shall be by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. If your name's not in the Lamb's Book of Life, you don't get in. You need to reserve a spot in heaven, and it's not .com, it's .Bible. You need to reserve your place in heaven. You need to say, Lord, not my will, but thy will. Here I am, Lord. Everything I know of me, I give to you. Write my name down. Now, I want you to know something. If you go to hell, because we haven't really talked a lot about hell in this sermon, but Revelation chapter 20, verse 15 says, anyone not found written in the book of life, what happened to them? They were cast into the lake of fire. You know why it says they were cast in the lake of fire? Because no one in the right mind is just going to say, make I'll take a dip in the lake of fire. They're going to have to be pushed. They're going to have to be thrown. They're going to have to be cast. It's going to be a fearful thing. It's going to be a frightening thing to go into the lake of fire. But I want you to know something. Our names can be written down in the book of life, and we can know it. Now, I want you to know something before I move on to my fourth and final point. I want you to know this. If you go to hell, you have jumped over the church. You have jumped over a Christian believer that's prayed for you. You have jumped over the Word of God. You have jumped over the Holy Spirit. You have ran through every single one of those, around every one of those, and through every one of those, and jumped over every one of those to go to hell. Because the Lord loves you so much, He has placed road stops or roadblocks in your way that you wouldn't have to go. Listen, nobody has to go. God doesn't send you. You make up your mind. Listen, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Number four, and finally, and I conclude, your confirmation number in heaven is JN316. That's your confirmation number in heaven, JN316. Now, what is JN316? Well, that's John 3:16. I mean, that's a verse that everybody knows. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Do you believe that verse? Let's say that. Do you believe that verse? Have you trusted that verse for your life? Well, let's do something then. And that's going to put that up on the board, and there's going to be a blank there where it says the world. And my name is John Hodges. And here's how it will go from, because he's talking about the world of people. For God so loved, and I'm going to say John Hodges. And if you've made reservation in heaven, I'm going to say John Hodges real loud like this so I don't overpower you. But I want you to call out your name, okay? Would you do that? We're going to say the whole verse. Are you ready? One, two, three, go. For God so loved John Hodges that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I hope you were able to say that and you meant that. And if you couldn't say that or you didn't mean that, I hope before this service ends you will say that and you will mean that and you will know that and you will have a know-so salvation and you will have a peace that passes all understanding. Listening, again, when you're traveling, you make a hotel reservation, you need to keep the confirmation number. And our confirmation number for heaven is John 3:16, JN 3:16. That is the Bible in a nutshell. That is the gospel in a nutshell. And if you know John 3:16, you know enough of the Word of God to go to heaven. And we just need to say, Lord, I give all that I have in me to all that I know of you. Here I am, Lord. It's a personal promise. Whosoever, the word believe, whosoever shall believe, the word believe means to trust. It means to place our faith in him completely. It means to trust wholly, 100%. That's what faith is. And the only way to be pleasing to God is Hebrews 11:6. It is impossible to please God without faith. And you have to have faith to please God. So what is our faith in? Is my faith in myself? No. My faith isn't in myself. Is my faith in the deacon body? No. Is my faith in First Baptist Church Salem? No. Is my faith in anything else? No. My faith, the object of my faith, has to be Jesus. And when he is the object of my faith and my complete faith, then I can have perfect peace that I have placed my faith in the correct object. Therefore, I will have peace with God, and I will have access to heaven, and my confirmation number will be written down. Listen, you say, I don't know if I can exercise that kind of faith or not. When you came in this building, you exercised faith by sitting in these pews, that it would hold you up. You exercise faith if you drove across a bridge, it would hold you up. If you took medicine this morning, you exercise faith that your doctor prescribed the right thing. Number two, that your pharmacist gave you the right thing. And number three, that it wasn't laced with cyanide from the company that you purchased it from. I mean, you have to have faith. Everybody has faith. But the point is, the object of our faith to go to heaven has to be Jesus Christ. Not our good deeds. It's not what we've done. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:8 and 9. Listen, it's not by works. It's by grace you've been saved through faith, that not of works, lest any man boast. Listen, our hope, our trust, our complete life is based upon what Jesus has done for me. Some people say, well, you know what? If you have to have a confirmation, John, then I think maybe you need to pay for it. You can't pay for it. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. He's already paid the price, and because he's paid the price, all you have to do is give the confirmation number, JN 3:16. Bam, you're in. Why are you in? Because you've totally trusted Christ. Anybody remember their honeymoon? I do. It lasted all of 4 hours. That's all we were in the hotel room, 4 hours. Maybe yours was longer than that. Maybe you stayed a week. I didn't know any better. I was too young, but I've learned. And we had a 25th and we went to Hawaii, and that was wonderful. I read this story, real story, about a manager who was a family friend of the bride and groom who got married, and for their honeymoon, they were going to go to Hawaii. I mean, they were going to have a bang-up time, but they had to spend one night before they got on the plane and headed to Hawaii. So this manager of this hotel comped them a room, and they came after the wedding, after the shower, I mean, after the following the wedding, they had reception. There you go. Thanks, honey. And they had this big reception, and after the reception, they drove to this real nice hotel, and they checked in. They said, your room's been comped. Make your way on up. Here's your card. All you have to do is put it in the door, open the door, and you're in. Well, they couldn't hardly wait. They got to their room. They opened the door, and it was this little tiny room. There was no bed. It was a fold-out couch. There was no shower. It was just a half bath. That's a toilet and a sink. Stunned. What a terrible trick to play on us. So they griped and moaned, pulled out the couch, and The only food they had, they were hungry, were these little high-dollar mini-bar foods, you know, crackers and peanuts and sodas, and you had to pay a fortune to get those things. And they weren't very happy, but they endured the night knowing that tomorrow would be better. They went downstairs to check out, to give their keys, and the manager said, "How was the room?" They really didn't want to say, but they said, "Well, I think maybe we were given the wrong room." "Well, why would you say that?" "Well, it's a fold-out bed. There was no shower or bathtub. It was so tiny." "Oh, that was just the den entering in. You didn't open the door to the master suite? In the master suite was a king-size bed with rose petals everywhere. There was champagne. And in the king-size suite, there was a jacuzzi ready to go and a 7-course meal. And you missed that." Well, I want you to know something. So many Christians have entered into the den, but they think that's all there is. And I want you to know that's not all there is. Right now, listen to me. We're in the den. Jesus said, "I am the door, and any man that comes in by me will be saved, and he will go in and out, and he will find pasture." I want you to know something. All you have to do, by faith, take that handle, open that door, trust in Jesus, place all your faith in him, repent of your sins, give your life to him, and go through that door, because that little parable that I gave you is a parable of heaven. Too many people say, "This is it. Isn't this great?" No! This just the tip of the iceberg. If you want the good stuff, by faith, you've got to enter in. And when you enter in, it's so good. Some of you are graduating college. Some of you have family that graduated college. Anybody in here that graduated college this time? This time, anybody graduate college? One. Congratulations. Where at? Amen. Two. Anybody graduate from high school this year? Just throw your hand up. One, there's a couple, yes. Some are to keep their hands up. Give them a round of applause. That's great. Listen to me, though. You've graduated college, now what? Oh, you say, "I want to go to college," for high schoolers. You say, for college, "Oh, I want to get in graduate school, or I want to go to the workforce." Good. Good. Then what? "Well, after I get in the workforce, maybe I'll get married." Good. Good. Then what? "Well, after I get married and have a good, really good job and start making some money, then I'll have some children." Good. Then what? "Well, I'll raise my children." Good. Then what? "Well, after I raise my children, maybe I'll retire one day." Good. Then what? "Well, after I retire, I'll travel and I'll enjoy myself and I'll see my grandchildren and great-grandchildren." Good. Then what? "Well, John, I guess someday I'll get around to dying." Then what? Then what? Then what? Then what? Because as sure as you're sitting here and I'm standing, you're going to die, and so am I. Then what? By faith, through grace, you can come and have life eternal. Would you do it today? Don't let anybody hold you back. If you need to join this church, you need to give your heart to Christ, you need to be saved, you need to be biblically baptized, whatever you need to do, if you need to come and pray about a lost family member, get it done today, because life is short and eternity is long. And our decisions, our commitments mean everything. Father in heaven, I do pray. I pray, Lord, that you would touch hearts, change lives. I pray, Father, that person that's sitting on the pew that's kind of debating, going back and forth, they want to, but they don't want to give up their life, will realize they don't have a life apart from you. And Lord, every breath that each of us have is a gift. Every heartbeat is a gift. The ability to move, to walk, to talk, to hear, to see is a gift. And Father, you can take those gifts from us anytime you choose. So, Lord, I pray today, while people are still able to see, hear, walk, and talk, they'll get out of their seat, get out of their pew, and they'll come to Christ and reserve that spot in heaven. not for $14.95 with a $10 upgrade, but Lord, through the precious blood of your Son, they would come. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Stand and come.